Hi, everyone. I'm ABC7 Chief Meteorologist Jim Reif.
And I'm NBC2 Chief Meteorologist Robert Van Winkle. The video presentation you're about to see is a recap of the events on August 13th, 2004, the day Hurricane Charley came to Southwest Florida.
Robert, it was truly a team effort. The weather staffs of NBC2 and ABC7 combining more than 100 years' experience to get us through Hurricane Charley. We want to acknowledge the help and assistance we had from many of our staff, including here at ABC7, Michelle Cunningham.
We are still going to be feeling the effects of Hurricane Charley.
And Ryan Phillips.
Okay, but just heavy sheets of rain.
And from NBC2, Eileen Javora.
Although Charley has left behind a deep stream of tropical moisture, and if you've been
senior meteorologist Tom Rector.
Have been following, of course, all the action.
And morning forecaster Jim Sion.
We're going to get weather. It's just how bad is that weather going to be?
Truly, it was technology that saved the day. The Doppler radar. We were glued to this TV screen as Charley was approaching the Southwest Florida coastline. And the NBC2 slogan, the Doppler radar that has the power to save lives, indeed, it did save lives.
It did indeed. Now we present a Waterman Broadcasting special, The Wrath of Hurricane Charley.
And of course, the hurricane warnings continue in effect along the Florida West Coast.
The eye of Charley is still south of Cuba.
There's the eye, exactly 235, 230, 215, 209 miles, 203 miles,
135 miles, 50 miles,
30 miles off the Lee County coastline.
140 miles an hour is a category 4 hurricane, and it is moving directly toward Lee County.
Friday, August 13th, 2004, Hurricane Charley strikes, leaving a path of destruction, and Southwest Florida changed in his fury. NBC2 and ABC7 present The Wrath of Charley.
This is the track that the National Hurricane Center of the storm is taking. What we're telling you right now is this is the track we are seeing on our live radar. This is a difference. This is obviously something that is concerning us. And we're continuing to track what we perceive to be a deviation on the course of this hurricane. It is on our upgraded system here, folks, the Viper system. If we could take a look at that, you can clearly see as we dot this and watch the eye, which is visible now. Jim, this seems a very persistent trend now over the last hour or so. This hurricane is moving northeast.
Yes, there's no question about it. Even though the National Hurricane Center has not declared this a major hurricane, this is, in fact, our major hurricane, and we are growing more and more concerned that this is going to be a major impact to us here in Southwest Florida.
Friday the 13th, Hurricane Charley now a Category 4.
The winds have just picked up severely to the point where I can barely hear you. They have deteriorated significantly over the past half hour.
This is why you can see the eye of Hurricane Charley now a Category 4 major hurricane. With 145 mile per hour winds, is getting dangerously close to the Lee Island coast.
The winds are just howling. I can't even describe how hard the winds are blowing.
You need to take protective measures now to protect your life and the life of your loved ones.
We are in Cape Coral. We're at Diplomat Middle School. And when we pulled in, we were part of a long line of cars. They're redirecting people to Cape Coral High School. They're saying that they are at capacity here. Let me see if I can speak to somebody real quickly. Ma'am, I'm with ABC7.
Yeah.
Who are you? Are you looking for someone?
Yeah, my daughter and her kids are supposed to be here right away, and she's not. And I can't remember her cell phone number.
Did you know that she was going to be coming here?
I told her, I said, you'll get her right now. And she says, okay, she's coming. She's got 5 kids and it's an Escalade.
Did you all decide, did she decide perhaps just in the last
yeah.
while to come?
Well, after I came, I called her after we found out it was a 4. You know, she said she'd come right away. Is that an Escalade? Can you tell?
Is that an Escalade? Thank you, ma'am.
That the latest Hurricane Hunter aircraft report now indicates that Charley has 140 mile an hour winds in a very small area close to the center.
Well, this is just impromptu. We got 4 guys out here. We just thought we would grab a camera and grab a mic, and as long as Todd feels comfortable, we'll step out here. Just in the course of the last 5 minutes while you were talking to Max, getting a lot of strong winds moving in. Keep in mind, while we have strong winds here at the surface, they're even stronger just 100 or 150 feet up. We're watching the tower. and we're trying to make sure that everything is secured there.
Again, Category 4 Hurricane Charley, now we're storm tracking it for you, continues to wobble around just off the coast of Captiva, making a beeline towards Sanibel. It turned to the north just about a half an hour ago. Maximum sustained winds around there still at 145 miles per hour. Now Boquilla, Gasparilla, Boca Grande under the gun. And I believe we can go to Todd Jurkowski here pretty soon, who has been standing by in Punta Gorda, right on the water there at Charlotte Harbor. Todd, it's getting a little worse, right?
Yeah, considerably. Every time we've checked in with you, the winds have gotten worse and worse. We've been using a wind gauge. We're blocked by the wind, and we're seeing gusts, you know, here 20 to 25 miles an hour. But if you look out into Charlotte Harbor, you really get an idea of the kind of wind and the kind of waves and rain that's being generated now this far up into Charlotte County. The boats are rocking considerably. I want to bring you around this way if I can, Brian. All the way around now, you're looking at the southbound end of you at the 41 bridge here, and you can see those trees blowing. They were blowing steadily east the last time we checked in with you. We're now seeing a little bit more of a jut to the northeast. I would assume, I'm not a meteorologist, but that means that the winds, the cycle of the winds are coming around here. We're getting a lot more rain, a lot more wind. All I could think about is when we were doing storm preps a couple days ago, Wayne Saliday from Charlotte County Emergency Management said one thing. If anyone still thinks that a hurricane cannot strike southwest Florida, Hurricane Charley is going to make a believer out of them. People in Charlotte County are seeing it here.
Folks, we've been out here all day. As you know, it's really hard right now. Go ahead and take a look out there. This beach was 275 yards all the way to the ocean. As you can see now, there's a river of water goes out over Estero Boulevard and is heading towards the back bay. That's how far it goes back. If you want to know how deep it is, look at that. I'll go ahead and zoom in on the door there. You can see it's almost 2 feet high. I would say about 2 feet high right now, and it continues to come in very, very strong. The winds are kicking up pretty intense out here. We were down earlier in Times Square before this river. These people on the pier walking around looking for a thrift. I cannot believe, and they plan to stay out there until this is all over. We also met up with another couple that got home from the Bahamas yesterday and were walking on Fort Myers, taking in the sights. It's totally unbelievable out here. But I'll tell you, it is here. The water is just absolutely amazing. It's coming over everything. See, the waves continue to crash over here. Some of the markers we were pointing out earlier have totally disappeared. They're totally under the water. Absolutely amazing. We'll continue to get pictures to you. That's the very latest I hear. I'm David Soto. We're live on Fort Myers Beach. We got Al Fifield here doing a fantastic job. Folks, we'll continue to provide these pictures for you throughout the day.
As you can see Boquilla on the right side of the storm. So now we have the Gulf of Mexico and the water piling through the passes there, going into the Pine Island Sound.
The wind is picking up. It gets stronger and stronger and stronger every single time. This is certainly the most action we're seeing as far as the water is concerned, with the white caps and the thick water and the thick waves and so on and so forth. I've been monitoring the water levels here. We're not seeing any type of a surge. Actually, water is being pushed out of the harbor at this point, but the rain is as strong as it's been, and the wind is as strong as it's been here. We actually heard a very large boom, an explosion or a transformer blowing, something like that, on the other side of the harbor. I can't tell you what it is, quite frankly, because we can't see on the other side of the harbor, which was not the case about an hour ago. But we're just hunkering down here. Believe me, we're safe. That's not a concern for us. We're waiting for the storm surge to hit, but we're not seeing that now. We're just getting a lot of wind, a lot of rain.
Wow, here we are at Fort Myers Beach. There's somebody down there walking around underneath that balcony on the first floor. We're at the Gull Wing Resort up on the second or third floor, looking down at the storm surge. And by the way, now I can clearly see on the side of the building there, this has come up about a foot in the last, I'm guessing, 20 minutes or so.
We're here right now on Vanderbilt Beach in North Naples. As you can tell, the wind really pounding this area. The sand is actually hurting my face right now because the wind is that strong. A lot of rain. The big concern here in North Naples, of course, is the storm surge. As this wind continues to pick up here, continues to move strong, it's going to move some of that water into the canals in Naples Park and start some major flooding there. I want to go ahead and pan over to the beach here. The beach is literally just about 10 feet ahead, but you can't even see that far. That's how treacherous things are getting here right now. The beach almost non-existent here. That's the very latest here in Collier County. Just wanted to give you you a look of how things are here, and as you can tell, the wind very strong.
On the screen right now is Fort Myers Beach. We've been watching water rise on the beach halfway up the first floor of most of the hotels along the beach. We are currently located at Gull Wing Resort. We're seeing waves actually breaking into the first floor of the hotel right there on at the Gull Wing Resort on the beach where we are located. Hurricane Charley bearing down Charlotte Harbor right for you. What's it like?
Yeah, Robert, we noticed it about a half an hour ago. We noticed a definite pickup in all the conditions here. The wind seems like it's going due west down Marion Avenue. And as I'm standing here, I'm watching trees literally get peeled away. There's limbs flying around. A piece of our building went flying down the street. We were getting set up to do a live shot for you to show you some of these incredible pictures. And a transformer on our street blew up. Sparks went flying, and we've lost power. I'm assuming that a good section of downtown Punta Gorda lost power. It's really too hard to even stand up. The wind is completely vertical. I don't know how well you can hear me because it just sounds like a freight train around us out here, but this just happened suddenly. I know you said that earlier, that when it hit, it was going to hit hard. There goes a tree right across the street from where I'm looking. Everything's swirling down here. It looks like it's an alley kind of effect where between the buildings in downtown Punta Gorda, it's just creating like a vacuum or something, and everything's shooting down the street. Pieces of signs are falling down. It looks like it's getting a little bit worse right now as we speak. I'm having trouble even standing up here. But as you said, it just picked up. Once it hits hard.
This is interesting. You can see the eye of the storm has now passed over northern Pine Island. I'm going to zoom in on this. You can see the eye has now passed over Boquilla. Now we're seeing on our street level mapping here, the Boquilla area is now popped out into the clear weather. Yes. Associated with the eye of a hurricane. Is that not incredible?
We're on the northern end of Pine Island. This is the last house actually out here. And this is the home of Jacqueline Britt. She was actually out here when the storm went through. Jacqueline, first, I just want to ask you what this was like.
It was unbelievable. I wasn't expecting this. I thought this is a real solid house and a Category 2. I was headed to Tampa. It didn't bother me. There's a, it's a stone and block house about a foot thick, and there's metal shutters. But so... thinking that mindset took me by surprise. It scared me because my husband's out of town. I was just here with my two little kids, and when we were upstairs and the roof started flying off, that's when it hit me. That's when it started worrying me. I thought the whole roof was going to go. So then we moved downstairs and kind of made a lean-to shelter downstairs. It was so loud, and I didn't, because of the shutters, I couldn't see what was going on.
This storm is headed directly up Charlotte Harbor toward downtown Punta Gorda.
Continues to get worse and worse here in Punta Gorda. I want to show you, move you over here. This gives you an indication of the winds we're starting to see. Palm trees are blowing, so on and so forth. The storm surge actually continues to move outward. We're seeing the water drop about since we got here a couple of hours ago. If you look over to the bay, the Charlotte Harbor, this is obviously the most wind we've seen, the most waves we've seen, the most rain we have seen. The boats to our right are actually holding down pretty well. They are harboring in the storm, if you will. But we actually just lost power to this part of downtown Punta Gorda. We're in a hotel at the Holiday Inn right by US 41. The power just went out in the hotel. We did have to lower our take care of our truck for a little while, but it's back up again and running well.
Nicole, go ahead.
Yeah, I'm sorry, guys. It's
That's
really
all right.
Hard
go
here.
Ahead.
Here at the Cape Cod Fire Station number 5, one of their large aluminum doors has just buckled and blown in, and now parts of the ceiling are falling down. These are made for these sort kinds of winds. We were all standing in front of them watching what was going on. They're very well braced, and all of a sudden, hit an ambulance. A lot of now that wind is coming in, and as I mentioned, parts of the ceiling are just started in the main section of the fire rescue building where the emergency trucks are. So far, it doesn't appear that anyone is hurt. They've got everyone gapped in sort of the living area right now and are locking the doors to keep people from going into that part of the fire station.
Guys, you're looking at live pictures outside the fifth floor of the resort, Mid-Island, Estero Island, Fort Myers Beach. You can see we are still getting pelted and pounded here. The storm surge, just incredible right now. We're talking 2 or 3 feet. This island is basically underwater. Just a few minutes ago, I got a chance to go down to the ground floor here and walk around just a little bit, and the water already was mid-shin at that point. Also, up to our knees. We walked out to the boulevard there. We saw
downed trees. We saw many pool cages, many lanais completely destroyed, blown around. Water boats that are in the canals out here are now as high as the homes because the water is just rising up out of the canals. Let me go ahead and show you how powerful the wind is here. This is our window. You can see my hand vibrating as the wind just pounds the window here at the Gullwing Resort. The good news is we are safe here. Everything is fine here at the Gullwing Resort. There are several other people here. We actually had a family earlier after hearing about that this was a safe building on our air came by to seek shelter because once this storm jumped up in intensity, they knew they had to get out of the home where they were. Look at the trees right now. You can see them really, really blowing. Just comes in waves, and waves is what we're seeing across the parking lot as the Gulf just invades where we are right now. And this is all saltwater. I can tell you when you're out there, it's almost like swimming. You just have saltwater caked all over you. It's dripping down everywhere. It is truly an amazing sight to behold as we've been here all afternoon and just watching the Gulf. It was 500 yards away from us when the day started. Now we're completely under. As you look, these parking lots are like rivers right now.
We're tracking Hurricane Charley now directly up Charlotte Harbor, moving to the northeast at 20 miles per hour.
Just here at the building, one of our large garage doors, I would say it's probably a 20 or 22 foot high door, has failed. So it's wavering in the breeze. And then on the east side of the parking lot, we've got a lot of, I'd say medium-sized branches down, again on the east side of the parking lot. But our palms continue to blow in the breeze. Most of our dishes are still looking okay, but just heavy sheets of rain continuing to come through, strong gusty winds that we already up there on the weather link reported gusts up to 76, and certainly we have much more to come.
Okay.
Todd Jakowski, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can, Robert. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Tell us what's going on.
We are at the Holiday Inn in Punta Gorda, as I've been mentioning, and we are now seeing unbelievable structure damage. This hotel is being ripped apart. The awnings are being ripped off. The tiki bar went flying about 6 feet into the air and into Charlotte Harbor. All, you know, there's shrapnel being whipped all over the place. We are sitting inside of our log truck, which if any of you have ever seen, are very large, very heavy pieces, and we're being knocked around. It's like an amusement park ride. Okay, right now we're seeing the winds. Trees are being blown over. I can't even imagine, even estimate the winds. I've never seen anything actually even this amount. But the building, the awnings and the roof and the blinds and the windows are literally, they're just being peeled off like it's a paper tree or something along that line. I don't know how else to describe it. There are people, we're seeing a tree, a huge tree right now, about a 15-foot tree being ripped up right out of the ground. It feels like our live truck is actually being picked up. I don't believe that that's the case, obviously, but it certainly feels like that. The entire roof of the pod, which was, I'd say, maybe 30 by 20, that just went straight up into the air like you would picture the house on The Wizard of Oz. It just went right up into the air and then out across the harbor.
Todd, I'm gonna go out on a limb here, and I think within the next 10 minutes or so, you're actually going to see the sun.
It's unbelievable. You made the call. It is. The sun is actually shining right now. There is still a wind blowing, but the sun is out. It's unbelievable. How fast it can change like that. I'm looking and I'm trying to see now that there's actual and our signs, hotel signs that have been ripped out, I can actually see a little bit more. There is still a little bit of wind blowing. Actually, it doesn't look like any rain.
Take a look at Doppler radar with us again. This is the storm's jogged off again to the north, and that's what is really incredible. There you can see in the last few frames of our radar. Here's Port Charlotte, Punta Gorda. Let me put it in motion again. Look at that. A turn right up Interstate 75 to the north.
And now the city of Arcadia is on the powerful side of what's left of this storm.
We're circling around Page Field right now, and I thought in the beginning there might be some damage here, but now we actually get to see what has happened. There are some planes obviously still left out on the tarmac. The owners had latched them down, but some of them have obviously suffered damage. We see a lot of trees down here, a lot of debris actually on the airport right now. One plane we saw was actually flipped completely upside down, just a mangled mess. The wheels were in the air. Some of them have bent propellers. Others are missing parts completely.
Jonathan Carlson, he's over at Edison Mall.
Mall. Jonathan, what are you seeing?
That's in Fort Myers, Jonathan.
Yeah, well, Edison Mall is completely flooded. The parking lot, there's about 2 feet of water there, completely flooding the parking lot. The apartment complex right next to the Edison Mall had three gigantic trees ripped out of the ground. They crashed onto a swimming pool, knocked over some palm trees. Now, there are residents coming out to see the damage right now on their porch, just stunned to see what happened. As for drivers on the road, pretty much a ghost town except for one or two cars that are coming by to see some of the damage.
We've got NBC2's David Sutter and ABC7's Sean Brown out there. Gentlemen, what can you tell us about the situation as it stands now?
Good afternoon and welcome to hour four of Hurricane Charley on Fort Myers Beach. As you can see behind me, she still is not letting me down, letting us all down here. As I'm joined right now by Sean. I'm losing it.
It's been a Sean long Brown. Time. That's okay. Sean Brown
is my counterpart with ABC out here. Obviously, we've been working together now for a good 24 hours out here on Fort Myers Beach. Sean just took a trip around the area out here. Tell us, what did you see?
Well, this is an example of some of the damage we have seen out there, David. Amazingly enough, a lot of the island holding up under the winds that we've seen so far. As I went out onto Estero Boulevard, which is about a half a block from where we are right now, we'll go ahead and step out and show you some of the power of the wind still blowing out here. The first thing you're going to notice, the streets, the parking lots, everything littered with debris from beach chairs to screens like the one I have in my hand to just lots of tree limbs. That's the main damage so far. Also saw a couple of screened-in lanais, pool cages that came down as well. But amazingly enough, not much damage to the houses. Now, this is just preliminary. I only walked a couple of blocks around the area just to check out what was going on. So, of course, we can't really judge. As you know, David, you've been in a hurricane before Hurricane Andrew. A lot of that damage didn't show up at first, and that's kind of what I saw. Tough to judge at this point, but it looks like Fort Myers Beach holding up. The big question is going to be storm surge. A lot of the damage we've seen so far coming from flooding.
Yeah, to be honest, we have a really nice condos around us here. This is a really good community. I'm a little curious to see how those wooden homes held up out here. Obviously, homes that were built around the time that Donna came through here, so they're very old out here. We're wondering how they're going to hold up. Obviously, this is our first opportunity to get you on the floor here on Fort Myers Beach. I want to show you the intensity out here. Obviously, it doesn't seem that intense because we're underneath the building, but when I step out here, watch what happens. I can barely stand up out here, and it is really intense. In fact, it's really a surprise how good the live truck has held up. Go ahead, Paul. Let's go ahead and look at the live truck here. This has been up against the building now for several hours, and it's been holding up really well. We were worried that it was going to go underneath water with the storm surge, but we're glad to see it still going, and hopefully we'll continue going to continue coverage, obviously, when this is all over, to get you a good idea, a clear idea of what's going on out here. Now, one of the ideas we got to think about out here is a lot of people won't be allowed on the island tonight, and we're still going to be wondering when that's going to happen, obviously.
And the conditions of the road, one of the things I was just checking with some of the locals to get a feel for how big the storm surge was out here that we experienced. I'm told probably 6 to 8 feet is what we saw. The parking lot we're standing in now was under about 2 feet of water. We were lucky here. Some of the neighboring condos completely went underwater. First floor condos, more than half of their floor was underwater. The water going up 4, 5, 6 feet into some of those condos. So those people are going to see a lot of damage. And again, we are just on the beachfront. We haven't gotten very far from where we are to see what else was done. We're going to have to wait for the wind and rains to die down so we can tell.
And when these winds die down, we'll definitely get a chance to get the live truck on Estero Boulevard and give you a clear view of what's going on out here. For now, it's Sean Brown with ABC and David Sutter with NBC and an entire crew out here of six members trying their best to bring it all for you.
And here you can see what we mean about the gradual lessening of this storm. This is live from Fort Myers Beach. For those of you listening to us on the radio, we're looking at some palm trees next to some high-rises on the beach. The palm fronds are literally blowing horizontally. I mean, it's still blowing very well down at Fort Myers Beach.
Hurricane Charley continues to pound southwest Florida with force. There's a considerable amount of damage and flooding out here. You can see over here, the parking lot of the Edison Mall is under a couple of feet of water. We've seen branches flying all over the place. A gigantic tree over here, uprooted construction projects, things flying all over the place. We've seen signs off of buildings come crashing down into the roadways, people's fences and roofs coming off of their hinges.
We have some pretty amazing video to show you. This is someone who happened to be at the right place at the right time, I guess you could say. It is from downtown Fort Myers. Watch the top of that building. Watch the wind blow. That is the Postal Service in downtown Fort Myers. You saw the roof ripping right off. He was getting video of downtown Fort Myers, and he happened to be there. He saw it lifting, and there you have it.
Mother Nature destroying.
The answer to the first question, is the storm gone? The center of the storm is indeed out of our area and working toward northern Florida.
We're off McGregor Boulevard in Fort Myers. Just to give you an idea of how bad some of the damage is in people's front yard, take a look at all these palm leaves that came crashing down here. If you take a look over here, you can see this gigantic tree which was uprooted and is blocking the street. If you take a look over this tree, you can see another tree which toppled down. This is a familiar scene in people's front yards here. Now, if you're thinking about venturing out, don't do that because these trees are in a lot of roadways and they're creating a lot of obstacles, not to mention the heavy rain.
We're in the Fiddlesticks development here in the southern part of Lee County. We found a tree in someone's yard just to show you how big it is. This is the root system, absolutely massive, taller than I am right now, but this just a small example of some of this damages that we've seen around town. Over on Daniels and Metro Parkway, a 7-Eleven gas station there with gas pumps completely destroyed by the winds of Charley. Also, a section of Daniels Parkway we drove along. It looked like a giant hand came and ripped out some trees and just scattered them all over the highway. You couldn't even see any pavement left.
You were up in Charlotte today, and we pulled our crews in at about 1 o'clock to keep those out of harm's way. Tell us what happened to you.
It's never felt so good to be back in Fort Myers, I can tell you that. I've been through many storms, and there's nothing that compares to this. I think it made a believer out of everyone. Our bureau in Punta Gorda is decimated. We lost the front wall, the side walls. We were inside at the time with pillows over our head as the walls came crashing in. And some people have it off a lot worse off than us. Going down the streets, the pictures are incredible. People lost everything, houses, all the way to the ground.
We've been taking calls from a lot of those people tonight as we look at some videotape from Charlotte County. You were in the bureau when the damage happened. You had to basically crawl out through some broken glass.
My photographer was shooting this video.
Mike Mason.
And I told him it was time to come in, and he was trying to cling to the wall. And right as I turned around, the plate glass windows broke in on me. And we realized that the walls were going down. And actually what happened is that when I ran to the back of the room, the walls started caving in. And Mike, the only reason he's here is that he crawled through the hole in the wall.
And Mike is okay?
Mike is okay.
What time was this? At what point during
in
Charlie's
approach?
In the 4 o'clock
hour. Because I looked at my watch at one point, and by 5:12, it was calmed down. And we didn't notice then that the wind had shifted the other way. And we high-fived each other because we knew we were halfway through.
Oh.
We do have some early estimates this morning on Hurricane Charley. As far as damage estimates, they are said to be about $15 billion. Obviously, that is very preliminary, but we do understand that would make Hurricane Charley the third costliest disaster in U.S. history. That is behind the September 11th attacks and Hurricane Andrew in 1992.
It is Andrew all over again. We believe there is significant loss of life.
You're going to hear a lot of sobering reports in the aftermath of this hurricane. One in particular, we've been talking about the Punta Gorda, hundreds of people missing there and the loss of life there.
We did lose some folks in a subdivision east of Punta Gorda, and we're still assessing that at this time.
Yeah, the reports are many, many people missing and many, many casualties. Could we maybe get a little bit more?
Have no idea. I'd like to. I know that's what everyone wants to know. That's what the world wants to know, and they'll know in due time.
Florida officials have now confirmed 16 people dead from Hurricane Charley. Now, earlier they had put that number at 13. Mm-hmm. There are no details yet on the three new victims that they have added to this death toll. And as we talk about this, you're going to be viewing video from Charlotte County.
And a house fire on Pearl Street on the beach was also something that emergency crews had to deal with. Plumes of smoke fed off the high winds. About a dozen firemen made it to the home. You're looking at some pretty spectacular videotape there of the flames. We're told the house looks like a total loss. There were reports that a house that backed up to that one also caught on fire.
Just damage everywhere. Check this out. This is what downtown Punta Gorda looks like. Nothing but devastation. And it didn't matter if you prepared for the hurricane. This business owner put sandbags in front of her door. Well, as you can tell, the windows were busted out. There's just things everywhere.
Well, to the city of Cape Coral this morning, waking up in darkness. We're told the damage here widespread but light to moderate. You can see here the white fence along Veterans Parkway completely destroyed. Now, most of the other damage reported, down trees, screen and lanais blown away, and some roof damage. There have been no flooding problems, we're told.
We have a big palm tree down on top of our boat.
It was horrible. It was very windy. Shingles were flying off of our roof.
In my house, it's about 2 feet of water. The storm was bad.
This is Pineland Marina. Look at this spectacle of all these hundreds of boats that are just crushed under this structure. And you can also see right here that there is a National Guardsman standing guard. No one is allowed into this facility, not only because of the danger of this being a very unstable structure, but also it's a hazmat situation because of all the fuel in there.
Come over here, and I'll show you a little bit also from two nights ago when we were here live. This boardwalk, it was strewn completely behind us with all sorts of debris up and down the storefronts. You look here behind me, and you see all of that has been gathered in a couple of piles getting ready to be picked up and taken out. So the debris cleanup continues.
A lot of debris, as you can see, also. Colusa Middle School, one that was just added to the list today of schools that have major roof damage. And this right here, this is the rooftop of North Fort Myers High School. We climbed up there to show you exactly what we're talking about.
You can see these houses. The roofs on these have been just torn off. We're still in a canal here in Boquilla, and right up in front here, a tree has fallen over, nearly blocking the entire canal. And these trees over here are just picked apart. There's just a mound of them on my right side over here that's just pretty much blocking this entire area. And it looks like there's a lot of debris caught up in that.
Check this out. We're in Punta Gorda Isles, and as you can see, this power pole has just split in two, making it very difficult for drivers with high vehicles to get down this street. And if you look just in the other direction down the street, you can see that a tree is hanging on those power lines there.
Wayne Saladay joins me now. He's the Charlotte County Emergency Management Director. And let's start with the hospital situation. What can you tell us with that?
Well, Jorma, we lost all three hospitals. They've all been shut down. They could not function. All of them had significant structural damage. The two in Port Charlotte lost their top floors. Charlotte Regional Medical Center here in Punta Gorda took a tremendous hit, lost their emergency room, and many of their systems failed during the course of the night. They did the best they can to hang on, but they had to begin transferring patients out of there this morning.
We have seen a significant amount of tree damage in East Fort Myers, Central Fort Myers, but nothing like what we have seen here in Fort Myers Shores. I'm going to let you take a look behind me here. I'm 5'3". This tree behind me is anywhere upwards of 16 feet that is completely uprooted in the back of someone's home and fallen on top of their home.
We are here in downtown Punta Gorda. We've been bringing you live pictures from this location all morning. I first want to show you some things here this morning. Everything's just toppled. Now I'm standing on the side of a building where the wind would be going that direction. You can still see windows just thrown out everywhere here. Down in the street, metal here twisted around these signs. A couch, part of a couch just twisted around this sign here. Here's Chad Drakowski. You'd like to make a couple comments.
I'm sorry, I just want to point something out. Aaron, just go around this way. You can see that big front loader there. As we were going live, I just want to point that out at how crude the cleanup efforts have to be right now. They're simply just trying to scrape whatever huge debris is blocking the road all through Charley County just to try to clear up the roads, and most importantly, so that the emergency vehicles can get through. I talked about the crude nature of that, but I talked to Wayne Saliday earlier from Emergency Management, and what he said was they want to do those things so that they can give the care to the families that need it.
You work all your life and it's gone in a matter of hours.
Today, the Allen family is trying to salvage what's left of their home.
It wasn't that bad till the roof went, and that's when it got hairy.
The couple and their three young children must now find a new place to live.
This house was just what I wanted to live in forever. I just can't believe it's gone.
I never liked this. I have never seen anything other than Andrew. I went down there when that happened. I've never seen anything up in this area like this. Hurricane Donner didn't do this much damage. But thank God we got our life.
This was all a screened-in porch.
Lost both.
Back was a screened-in porch. We just had that new siding put on there less than a year ago. New roof, new siding.
Thank God we got our life, though.
Yeah, I'm thankful I'm alive. That's one thing for sure. God was with us, but just it's too much. I mean, it's heartbreaking to look around and see all this stuff that's destroyed. We put so much money into this place and long years and stuff, and it's just, it's all gone.
It looks like there's no house here that's left unscathed. Again, it's pictures that we've seen throughout Charlotte County. Many of the homes, there's nothing left. Some of them look okay. And it's all a matter of standards. You get loose to seeing so much wreckage that when someone's just missing part of a roof, it seems like it might be livable again because their next-door neighbor has absolutely nothing. This is the Riviera Marina, which is at the end of Rio Villa. The boats that were left in here in the storm are thrown about like they're toy boats. You see a lot of oil in the water. There's a big oil slick. But just past that, that's where people actually stored their boats. It's one of the structures where the boats were stored several stories high and taken out with forklifts. It's collapsed on itself, and so all the boats are just stacked up there.
Lots of destruction here on the northern part of Captive Island. It's about a half mile wide at this part of the island. We're on the bay side, and we're seeing a number of homes with parts of rooftops missing. A lot of large debris thrown about in the lawns and here in the bay. For you fishermen, you may want to make note, this is a new pass created by Hurricane Charley. It's a couple hundred feet wide. It is literally cut in two, Upper Captiva Island. We're now coming up on what is now the northern part of Upper Captiva Island, created by the hurricane and the new pass. Northern Captiva Island, just before we approach Upper Captiva, there's about a half mile wide stretch here of island, the widest part of Captiva Island, and it looks as though Charley decided to make quite a mark here. Rooftops and trees are all impacted significantly by the storm. Pool cages as well. A number of homes here in the widest part of Captive Island. Utility poles, all of them with damage of some degree here on the northern part of Captiva. Lots of destruction here on the northern part of Captive Island. It's about a half mile wide at this part of the island. We're on the bay side, and we're seeing a number of homes with parts of rooftops missing. A lot of large debris thrown about in the lawns and here in the bay on the other side of the island opposite the beach side. We're directly above South Seas Resort at the northern tip of Captive Island on the east side of the resort, where a number of the roofs of the larger villa complexes have been blown about. There's Lots of destruction here on the east side of this very popular resort destination on the northern tip of Captiva Island. We're flying now a couple hundred feet above Estero Boulevard in Fort Myers Beach, and we're seeing some of the sand that's been blown over by Charley.
Hi, Sam.
The several feet of storm surge that the island occurred here on Friday. There's lots of sand still on the main thoroughfare, Estero Boulevard. Lots of trees and debris strewn about. Now a couple hundred feet above Times Square on the northern tip of Narrow Island, Fort Myers Beach. You can see the mandatory curfew is in place and being heeded by residents and visitors alike, as there's little activity here in Times Square on a Sunday in August. Ordinarily, there'd be literally hundreds of people on the beach and on the Fort Myers Beach pier.
Fort Myers Beach is one of those places where a lot of people have been clamoring to get back on the island, and as of yet, they have not been allowed back on.
Deputies and National Guardsmen are preventing island residents from getting to their homes.
I want to scream. I want to choke somebody. This is where we got to stay till we get over the bridge.
Are you angry?
I'm angry. I'm frustrated. I feel I was denied.
Mike Baldica is on Fort Myers Beach. And Mike, I understand a meeting's going on, but you are not inside. They won't let you in.
That is true, Sharon. As you can see, we're standing out in the hallway right now. This is the closed door of this meeting. Now, earlier the door was open and we had a microphone in there, but we were told to leave. When I was brought up the issue of whether or not this violated the Sunshine Law, which basically would give us public access to this meeting, the deputy city manager told me that they will deal with that.
We are on the other side of the bridge on Fort Myers Beach, where, as you can see, they have just opened up this bridge. Cars are just finally starting to come across for the first time.
Got water in the door now for sure. There we go. You guys,
we'll follow you in.
This is worse than we expected.
Gabriel was nothing.
That window broke.
Two before, big piece of timber came right through.
And it's just totally demolished it. We couldn't even get inside.
Boats piled on top of one another, more than 100 damaged.
It's unbelievable. I mean,
it's hard to believe that it could be torn up like it is.
You can see the roots of the banyan tree through the brush towering over their home.
This huge tree right here was just basically uprooted. I'm 5'8" tall, and this is easily more than double my size. And
this is all the stuff that was in two of the rooms that we lost. I have no idea whose roof that is.
That's not your roof?
Tornado touched down in the area, tore up the back house, back part of the house pretty good. Knocked down just about every single tree.
But it's got to be an emotional toll knowing that all these people have lost everything.
Donna was bad, and I think this one's a little worse. Get the neighborhood back to normal, trying to get everything to the street so that the city, when they move through here, they can pick up everything and kind of move on with their life, too. They're doing a tremendous job of cleanup.
We're finding as we go throughout Charlotte County today that a lot of places just don't even know where to start as far as cleaning up the neighborhoods, that sort of thing. Of course, a lot of attention over the last 3 days has been focused on the towns of Punta Gorda and Port Charlotte, but it is important to remember there is a lot of damage in the more rural areas of Charlotte County as well.
There are 2,400 homeless due to the storm. They're staying in 21 emergency shelters across the state.
This is my home. Ain't much. But the most important thing is, we're all alive.
That's pretty smelling.
Pretty bad up there.
So you consider yourself pretty lucky at this point?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. I think it took them just my carport, a little bit of roof. Yeah, that's from more than that area, you know? A lot of people don't have nothing left. You know, I feel sorry for them, but Lord only gives us so much we can handle, you know?
Yeah, the house is gutted. I pray to God nobody was inside it.
You don't want to be in one of them things. You don't know what an eye is until you hear one.
I've never seen a storm like that here, and I've been here 27 years.
But the federal government and the state government is to surge resources as quickly as possible to disaster areas. And that's exactly what's happening now.
Governor Bush is coming up here live. I'd like to get him live. Hi, Governor. I'm with WBBH here in Fort Myers. I just had one question for you, if I could.
Yeah.
We talked with you over at the Emergency Operations Center. Now you're on the ground. The perspective from the ground as opposed to in the air of what you're seeing.
Well, the same devastation, but now with a human context. When you're in the air, what you see is the properties lost. When you're on the ground, you talk to people. We've had a chance to visit with people who've lost everything, who are fearful about the future, who've lost their business or lost their home. And so it puts a human context on the devastation, which is why we're here. We're here to give them confidence that there will be support. There already is support, and there'll be a lot more of it in the days ahead.
Getting the power back on has been a major concern for hundreds of residents.
We understand today they say it could take weeks to restore power in those hardest hit areas. And here's some people pulling power lines because they were caught in trees right across the roadway, got stuck in that semi truck that you saw there.
Wow, look at this. Just lined up.
Rows of power crews coming to help, and we understand that they're coming not just from Jacksonville, but across the state. You can imagine people are pretty anxious to get their power back on and their ACs and everything going with that.
Yeah, we've heard a little bit about that in the last few days, too.
Some grumbling going on, but I know that people are very happy when they get their power.
How long have you been waiting for gas?
Going on 2.5 hours. I'm coming out of Punta Gorda.
From Punta Gorda you've
come down? I've got gas cans for generators.
And this is the first gas station you found?
Yes. Well, there's another one up and down the line, but it's just long.
And they are lining up at any gas station that is open. And on North Fort Myers on U.S. 41, there are 3 gas stations open right now. But each one of them has a line that is more than what we're being told, an hour to an hour and a half long.
Well, here in Charlotte County, we're starting to see more and more examples of people coming out to help each other. And we've got Jimmy here with West Coast Fuel. Can you tell me what you're doing out here?
We're giving away 10 gallons for every resident of Punta Gorda, free fuel because they can't get to the gas stations and stuff like that, and get cans for the generators.
Remember, stay away from the hospitals in Charlotte County. 3 of them sustained enough damage to actually put them out of commission.
We're told that the emergency departments, basically in all of the hospitals, we're talking to our producer, is that up in Charlotte County?
Yeah, Lee Memorial.
Lee Memorial Health Systems and in Charlotte County, the emergency people are looking for as many physicians as they can. that can give it Go to ahead. Patrick that can help them out.
As crews work to bring the Charlotte Regional Medical Center back to life, FEMA doctors and nurses work in these tents to keep people from losing theirs.
We're also seeing a lot of people that are being injured. There's lots and lots of broken glass and nails to be stepped on, and we're seeing a lot of lacerations.
This temporary emergency room got going on Saturday morning. So far, they've treated more than 200 patients, a lot of them suffering from heat stroke.
You got to pull together in time like this, in time of crisis. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, that's real talk. All right, nice talking to you.
There's nowhere else to go. The home he shares with his wife and young son David was destroyed.
We had to stay here, you know, we don't have no place.
It's been crazy. We just want to go home. You know, that's the main thing. And we finally found out where our electric's been turned on.
We're full to capacity, but we're not going to turn anybody away. I'm hearing from the Red Cross that we are at capacity, whatever that level is, and over and beyond it. However, we will not turn anybody away. We will try to accommodate everybody as best as possible.
Here at Lee County Animal Services, they are continuing to bring in some of the strays that may be related to all of this storm damage. Animals have a tendency to get out when something like this happens, and also many folks unfortunately left their pets behind when the storm hit.
Flyers being delivered all through town today so that people have a place to go. There was a woman last night who slept in her driveway with her two dogs because she didn't know where to go and her home was gone.
Walmart employees working hard today to get shelves restocked and ready for the morning rush.
We have about 17, 18 people total for the whole supercenter to stock and fill the whole store overnight.
Some needy customers arriving here as early as 5 a.m.
Oh, it's great. All they need was to have the ice today for me.
Give me that personal water.
You and me, come on.
That's six, three more.
This is Comfort Station C in downtown Punta Gorda.
Eight people, two families, it's eight people. Water and ice? Yes. Do you need any latrines, any water bottles to take with you?
We're giving them whatever they need.
And these people need just about everything.
I'm from the American Red Cross, and I'm just here to check to see if you'd like a hot meal. We've got lasagna.
I would love a hot meal.
Okay, it cooks right in the box. You don't need any electricity. You just follow the directions. It's okay. A chemical reaction. It just steams in the box.
That's
How
fine.
Many does your family need?
Well, I'm here alone. I'm on vacation.
Oh.
I'm down here. This is my mother's house. My mother just had to go to a nursing home about a month ago. I came down here to just be with her. And it's a great place for a vacation usually, but not this time.
More and more shipments are coming in here to the Convoy of Hope as people are just bringing in tons of canned food supplies, also water, ice, bread, pretty much anything anybody would need after they've gone through a disaster. And a lot of people out here today say they are thankful.
SpaghettiOs.
Clorox for your toilet.
This means a whole lot to us.
This is absolutely fantastic.
Yeah, I just really appreciate everything, every little thing.
Victims of Hurricane Charley left with destroyed homes got a helping hand today from the Convoy of Hope.
We've responded to virtually every major disaster in the United States in the last 4+ years, including 9/11.
More than 40 tons of food, water, cleaning supplies, all for free. Necessities for survival during a disaster.
I am so glad because a lot of us don't prepare, and we thought we had prepared, but we were not prepared for what happened.
Some, enduring their own hardships, even shelved their worries in place of others.
Everything you do comes back three times fold. We were helping yesterday. Somebody helped clean our yard out of the tree and everything, so everything goes around.
My dad was staying here, and I was going somewhere else, and I'm like, I hope he doesn't get hurt. I'm thinking that's kind of good because it's good is because we have no electricity, and that means we can bond a little more. People can bond with their families because they have to work together to survive.
One of the positives that came out of this terrible tragedy in Punta Gorda is the relief effort by many of the people here. They want to help out, and they want to help these people as much as possible.
Some people were lucky and some people weren't so lucky. Mm-hmm. What amazes me is how many of the trees are down, but also what amazes me is how clean it is. Yeah. I mean, the crews did an incredible job.
Trying to get some food.
We're living, you know, tuna fish and peanut butter and jelly and stuff like that.
But the number one request from residents.
Just water and ice.
Something many of these people haven't had in days.
How's that taste?
It's hard to beat.
That's your first drink in how long?
3 days. I've drank everything that's liquid but water. Couldn't find any.
George Alexander survived on anything he could. Instead of water, he drank things like soup.
You name it. If it was wet, it went down. I'm a little bit hoarse.
The cell phones don't work. I mean, you get somebody and it breaks up and we lose them.
They need a way to communicate.
One more down, all the way down.
The Cassios haven't talked to their son since Charley hit.
Hi, son.
Their phones don't work, so we loan them ours.
I love you, son. Yeah, we're good. We're safe. Everything's good. We just got no water and stuff, but we're getting it. We'll make it.
We'll make it. A phrase you hear echoed throughout Charlotte County.
Everybody's coping. I haven't heard people whining and carrying on.
There's people we never met before, and all of a sudden, since this has happened, we've had people come out, people were all giving each other ice and water, and we're cooking in the afternoons, giving each other food and stuff, and it's just unbelievable. And just the whole, I mean, just the whole place has just come alive. It, you know, just everybody's helped each other, and, you know, it makes you feel good to be an American.
I'm out here to help people because I know our house is fine, but other people, my friend Dylan's mom came and she was crying and I gave her a hug because her house was gone. I told her it was all right and she got some stuff and she went home.
Nobody's prepared for anything like this, so you really have to appreciate what everybody's been doing.
Thank you.
Friday, August the 13th, 2004, is certainly a day that will go down as one to always remember here in Southwest Florida. Too big of an event to document in just an hour's time, so we're pleased to be able to offer you some extras on the Wrath of Charley that, because of time constraints, we were not able to show you in the main story.
This extra footage includes aerial shots of some of the areas most devastated by Hurricane Charley and a behind-the-scenes look at how our news crews covered this story of a lifetime. So now more on the Wrath of Hurricane Charley.
This is a summary of Doppler radar imagery from the afternoon of August 13th, and the storm that was approaching Sanibel had rapidly intensified to a Category 4 hurricane. What you're seeing here is the jog the storm took away from Sanibel and up toward Captiva, passing over northern Pine Island and right up Charlotte Harbor, directly for Punta Gorda. The time here is roughly between 3:30 in the afternoon and 5 o'clock in the afternoon. Of course, not to be forgotten, DeSoto County, you see the storm moving to DeSoto, was still a strong Category 3 hurricane.
I actually think it's not going to hit that hard. I think it's going to pass us and go to Tampa, like they said.
Even as Hurricane Charley turned toward Southwest Florida, some people on Fort Myers Beach were still in denial. But when the storm surge began to creep up, everyone's mind began to change.
We can imagine that within the next hour or two, this entire area where we're standing will be completely submerged and underwater.
Our crew of six began to set up in the Gullwing Resort.
When things go bad out here, when the water starts to get a little too high, where we have a cable going up right now, as you can see, crews are working right now. We're trying to get a cable strung to the fifth floor of this building.
As the hurricane approached, one crew stayed live on the air.
Here, give you a clear idea of what we're facing.
Another kept track of the surge.
It gets closer by the second, which is why we are about to head to a place of safety, which is where you need to be right now.
And photojournalist Chris Cruz and myself took one last survey of the island. We couldn't believe what we found in Times Square.
Ma'am, what are you doing out here?
Well, he wanted to see a hurricane and we came to have fun and...
You're having fun? You think this is fun?
Yeah.
As we watched Hurricane Charley pound the pier, the message came across my pager. Charley, a Category 4 hurricane. Crews on the island seek shelter. All three crews headed up to a safe room on the fifth floor. Photojournalist Paul Fifield captured the hurricane live by shooting through protected glass. Within moments, storm surge took over the area, first creeping up the lawn to our right, then putting the first floor of the building on the left halfway underwater.
Go ahead and take a look out there. This beach was 275 yards all the way to the ocean.
With the surge, the winds began to kick up. Reporter Sean Brown.
Because the water is just rising up out of the canals. Let me go ahead and show you how powerful the wind is here. This is our window. You can see my hand vibrating as the wind just pounds the window.
Surprisingly, our live truck stayed up through the wind and 2 feet of surge. Meanwhile, standing up in the hurricane became quite a challenge.
For now, reporting with Paul Fifield, I'm David Sutta. Now back to you.
No, I'm saying.
With hurricane parties going on in the hotel, our photojournalist moved around the fifth floor to get better vantage points. Around 6 o'clock, we ventured out to survey the damage. We dodged hills of sand and random furniture on Estero Boulevard and homes that sit smashed in. Two homes that weathered the storm burned to the ground. So much destruction, we could only point the camera in every direction and capture something incredible like this massive sinkhole.
I saw waves coming up to our doorstep. And at that point, I was thinking, storm surge, that's the worst part.
Yet despite the widespread destruction, people we found wandering the area were optimistic.
You're going to see a community here of people that are going to come together and help each other out. It's the way the people are here, and they're survivors.
Survive, we already have. On Fort Myers Beach with photojournalist Paul Fifield, Chris Cruz, and Joel Kattner, and reporters Dan Sheldon and Sean Brown, I'm David Sutta for NBC2.
As we have gone along the coastline here, there is some damage to the roofs. I do not want to minimize the damage on Fort Myers Beach, but if you are going to compare Fort Myers Beach to, say, North Captiva, to Boquilla, where the eye of the hurricane went over, and of course to Charlotte County and Arcadia, there is quite a bit of damage on Fort Myers Beach, but it is nothing like some of the other hardest hit areas. And I'm sure you will remember that at one point, the eye of the hurricane looked to take a different path, and it veered and went over North Captiva. So Fort Myers Beach, it could have been a lot worse to sum things up. I know all the people out there that live on the beach who want to return to the island don't want to hear this, but so far, if you compare, the damage is there, but it could have been a lot worse. If Jim Sine is in the Weather Center, I would love to talk to him about storm surge, because I know when this was a Category 2 storm, Jim, the big problem we were worried about was the storm surge. And you see examples of this, Jim. Just to kind of give you some bearings, Jim, I know you wanted to know where we are. We're just a little bit south of the bridge. And I know that we were thinking a much higher storm surge than what they got on Fort Myers Beach, even though there are examples of that. There's a good look at some of the communities down there, and obviously some roof damage there. As you see, a great look right there at one of the Army vehicles. I don't believe there is a martial law at this point in Fort Myers Beach. From what I can tell right now, there is sand on the roadway, but it's not to the extent that it would hamper you from driving. You may want to take it slowly, of course, once they let you back on the island, but no, I don't think it would hamper driving efforts at all, especially with all the SUVs on the road, and a lot of people have four-wheel drives. It looks like there's some construction equipment right there. They are having to deal with the storm surge, obviously, and these folks, you gotta tip your hat to them, give them credit. They've been working nonstop. Well, see, actually, there's an example of old style, looks like a metal roof there that did not fare as well. So we've moved on from Fort Myers Beach to about the central portion of Sanibel, not quite to Captiva. Some amazing video of some of the damage that Hurricane Charley caused with those 145 mile per hour winds as the eye moved a little bit west of here on northern Captiva. But take a look at what we're about to show you. As we zoom in here into this house, how about that? You can actually see inside this room. You can see a lone lamp standing there. And so some unfortunate homeowner who has not been able, actually this is Sanibel Island, everyone, back in the booth. This is not yet Captiva, but this poor unfortunate homeowner who hasn't returned yet to their home. Now this is certainly Gulf side here, but that's what they unfortunately have to look forward to. But just next to it, It is amazing how there seems to be some kind of a contrast in the selection that these storms choose. Some homes look horrible. There's quite a bit of damage, and others do much better. The theme here, as we move down from Fort Myers Beach to Sanibel, the damage gets progressively worse. Yet still, Sanibel city officials looking for maybe a glimmer of positive news here have, again, much like Fort Myers Beach, have said it could have been worse. Just a slight wobble on the track of that hurricane, and we could have been talking about catastrophic losses. But if you're this homeowner, this is a catastrophic loss to you. If you'll take a look there, there is a row of homes there which all have some kind of roof damage. As you can see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 right there, they all have damage. And from up here, it looks relatively minor, but then again, you show that shot, and it's a little more serious. I want to show you some amazing damage. There is quite a bit here. At, as I mentioned, one of the most popular resorts in all of Southwest Florida. As you look right there, the roof is sheared off. That's a couch right there next to the wall. The roof has been taken off. In fact, Jim was asking me earlier about the damage on Sanibel. How widespread is it? Well, basically, almost every structure that you'll see here at South Seas Plantation has some kind of damage. There are a few buildings where the roof is left intact, but primarily, you're talking about a lot of damage here. But ironically, when you look at all this damage, the good folks here in the chopper also noticed the fact that if you take a look at the boats here in the marina, they look fine. The boats look fine, and also there is a large congregation of jet skis as well. I don't know if we can show you that, but the same thing, they're doing just fine along with the boats. You take a look at them right there. They moved them to that location. You got 145 mile per hour wind coming through. The roofs are lost here on many of these resort buildings. We're talking about a multi-million dollar complex, and yet the boats, if you'll remember, we showed you for the last couple of days all the damage at Pineland Marina on Boquilla. That whole marina was trashed, every boat there. We're talking about millions and millions of dollars in damage. But so how ironic that these boats fared fairly well. Take a look at that. That's exactly what you're talking about. Can you believe that? I know we've shown this before, but I was amazed. This was actually one contiguous island. It was all intact. And now, I believe that we're talking about 400 nearly 500 yards of coastline of this island that has been removed, thanks courtesy of Mother Nature. That is northern Captiva. That is the portion of Captiva that is only accessible by boat. Now, in this portion of Pine Island, where the eye actually went by it, but it was a little to the west. So I want to show you a contrast. The earlier one we showed you, there was complete devastation. Now, there is quite a bit of damage here. You can see quite a few of the manufactured homes obviously have damage. Some are destroyed and are unlivable, but if you take a wide shot of the entire community, this particular one fared much better. So there are many homeowners here on Pine Island who will be returning, and they will have somewhere to live. It's A-OK. So it is amazing the way that the storm selects communities. Obviously, these homes are not livable. But once again, we're trying to find some positive in a sea of negativity. And if you go north to the end of Boquilla, it's a much different story here in the central part of Pine Island. This is a little bit south of the Winn-Dixie. For those of you who live on Pine Island, these homeowners fared much better.
Can't help but notice throughout this section of Punta Gorda on Rio Villa, all the trees are brown because they're stripped of their leaves, and the tree that's littering this area is a mess. It's actually up in the trees in many cases. I don't know how people are ever going to go out and pick all this debris. It looks like a lot of it's aluminum, metal. There's a boatyard just down from here. Maybe it's a mixture of some of the siding from some of the mobile home parks. Some of the homes are totally demolished, and there you have a home next to it, which looks like it's pretty much intact. We're looking at another one of the mobile home communities. Again, it's pictures that we've seen throughout Charlotte County. Many of the homes, there's nothing left. Some of them look okay, and it's all a matter of standards. You get loose to seeing so much wreckage that when someone's just missing part of a roof, it seems like it might be livable again because their next door neighbor has absolutely nothing.
Charlotte County can't find it.
Yeah, there were a couple of houses down there. Like that one, look, it's totally gone.
Yeah, look over there. There's a void where there's this pile. And we stopped here because you can see some of these power poles, which are literally down on their sides. And that's what the power officials, power authorities are so concerned about, trying to upright these, restring them, put in new poles where needed. Now he can take it straight in. Mobile home park for some stories before, and talking with the residents here, they prize their pristine view. That's Shell Creek. It's right behind them. There are not too many homes here. This is not a real large mobile home community, but they've had a beautiful location, and it looks like they've taken severe damage here. You can see one coming up here on our left, totally demolished. It looks like there's no house here that's left unscathed. We're going into downtown Punta Gorda now. You can see on the left, that's the historic courthouse. This building we're on top of right now, this glass structure, that's where the Charlotte County Newsroom for NBC2 is located. As we're going further in, all the homes you see here are historic homes. This is the historic district of Punta Gorda. Yeah, many of the homes here date back to 1912. They were mostly cracker-style houses with Spanish-style mixed in. Now, many of the people here that we spoke to on Wednesday were determined to stay in their homes. They felt the houses had lasted so long and been through so many storms, they felt very secure in them. We did check back in on Friday, and a few of them were totally ruined. This is considered the business district for downtown Punta Gorda. The professional center, which was there on our right, that housed a lot of law offices, the NBC2 News Bureau. Most of what you're seeing down here were once businesses. They were trying to revitalize the downtown. You can see some of the murals, ironically, which depict Punta Gorda's history, are still intact. This way. This is the old Punta Gorda Mall, which is off to our left side right now. It was just last week, the week before the hurricane, they took down the landmark sign that said Punta Gorda Mall. They got it down just in time. They're going to be putting the city marketplace here. They've been in the process of demolishing part of that mall, and you can see what's left of it is now demolished as well. Off to our right, you can also see That's the historic clock on Marion Avenue. If people have driven through the historic district for years, they've been able to look at that clock. The clock's still standing, but many of the other businesses on that street are now demolished. We're using it as a staging area right now for a lot of the TV crews. I can see them giving out relief supplies. That first building that you see is a two-story building on Marion Avenue. That's Marion and US 41. That was the waves of grain. You can see the entire top floor is missing from that. Just down from there, there's the hardware store, which is, you see the mural on the side of the building? That was a hardware store, now totally gone. The Holiday Inn is where the NBC2 news crew was set up on Charlotte Harbor. We were asked to move at one point because they felt it was too dangerous to keep people in the building. They had extensive damage. The roof is gone. The main building you're looking at, that's what housed all the conference rooms and the restaurants. They've had quite a bit of damage there. Their hotel parking lot is now housing rubble, which used to be inside those buildings. Okay, this is the area right on the Port Charlotte side in Charlotte Harbor. This was the Harbor Inn. It's entirely wiped out. You can literally see down inside of the rooms. There's no roof to speak of whatsoever. Just past that is the Raw Bar, and it looks like it fared fairly well. Some of these buildings you're seeing right here along Charlotte Harbor, that was a marine store. The Putt-Putt Golf Center looks like it's not doing too badly. We're going to get another look at the Harbor Inn.
Okay, got a close shot on it.
Okay. Believe it or not, the Harbor Inn was where some people planned to go for their evacuation because they took pets. You can see it was not a good choice. They've lost not only their roof, you can see they're literally gutted. We're looking right now down inside the hotel room. Quite a bit of damage. All that lumber, it looks like matchsticks on the ground. You can see beds, dressers, commodes. This is Charlotte Harbor on the Port Charlotte side. These are some of the older homes on the around the waterfront area in Port Charlotte this time. There was a lot of concern about these homes because this area is so low-lying. They were concerned they'd be washed out by storm surge, but instead it was the wind that really ripped them apart. I think we're going to turn here and go more towards the water. The houses are kind of sporadic through here. You can see power companies right now working to get some of the lines up and running. The first attempts to get power back in this area. This building here, the two-story building we're looking at, that was the Florida Adventure Museum. It had just relocated here about a year ago. It looks like they took a lot of damage to their roof tiles. You can see all their windows have blown in. Yeah, some of these houses are also some of Charlotte's oldest homes. There are a lot of very small wood houses here. It's amazing any of them are left standing. I believe we have a condominium unit. That was a rental unit. The top floor is missing on that. You can see literally into the house. There's so much scattered wood around. In some places, it's just in piles. It's hard to tell whether there had been a structure there or a lot of the wood just literally blew there. The building you see with the blue tarps on it, that was the Harbor Town apartment. That was one of the only places in Charlotte County for affordable housing. And right in front of it, on US 41, that used to be an internet store. I believe there was a bait and tackle shop in there. And there's so much contrast between the new and old construction. This new Walgreens looks like it's perfectly intact, while across the street, the Rhodes Furniture Store is left in tatters. This was at one time some of the most prized property in Charlotte County. It's right off the Peace River as you're going into Deep Creek. The street we're looking at is off Harbor View Road. That house down there, we're looking at that wood house. There's nothing left of it. The homes next to it look fairly new, and many of them fared pretty well. But that wood house, there's nothing left to it. The boat in the backyard is sunk. It's hard to even tell what they had on their property because it looks like a bunch of pickup sticks around there. The debris from that home is scattered at least a block away. These homes are kind of a mix of new and old. You can tell the new construction, which is stayed more intact. Some of the older homes, like the one we're looking at now, maybe built in the 1970s, has a lot of damage.
Here's one lost through.
Oh, yeah. That one lost its roof entirely. You can look into the house. It looks like it was made with some kind of aluminum siding. You see a lot of the houses here. People are already starting to get tarps up. Now we're starting to see a lot more damage. Roof damage. See another home there. Yeah, that's it. You see another home there on the left. It looks like half the house is gone. The garage and the upstairs area is intact. The other side of the house is missing. Again, we're off Harbor View Road. These houses back up to the Peace River as we're going into Deep Creek area. The boat upside down. The damage here is just heartbreaking. A lot of these people work their entire lives to retire and have a home on the water. I don't know what they have to come back to. Many of them are going to find their homes beyond repair. We're now in Deep Creek. You can see there's been a lot of roof damage here. People have been very quick to get out here and put tarps on their roofs, though. But it's hard to see a house that doesn't have some type of damage. A lot of pool cages twisted and gone, but I'm sure that's the least of their homeowners' worries. They're more concerned about their home. But there have been, again, a lot of tiles missing, in some cases, entire roofs. You've got a home under construction there. All the lumber is scattered around in it. You see an older home sandwiched between these two red roofs. It looks like it took a lot of damage there. The house across the street is missing a roof. You've got people that have covered their roofs entirely with plastic because we've been having these afternoon rainstorms.
We want to thank you for purchasing a copy of this historic record of Hurricane Charley. Your donation is greatly appreciated and will help the thousands of victims of this Category 4 storm.
And for all the people who lost their lives and their homes to this powerful storm, we know your loss will be felt for years to come, and our thoughts and our prayers go out to you.
We also want you to know that the visual images and the people who appear on this video by no means represents all the people who had a hand in covering Hurricane Charley. In order to get the information across, dozens more worked tireless hours behind the scenes and in the field.
Again, we want to thank you for your donation, and we do hope this video captures what Southwest Florida experienced Friday, August the 13th, 2004, and the days that followed the wrath of Hurricane Charley.